Hello friends, welcome to Embedded IoT Enthusiast Learning Space. In today's video, we will be discussing about mainly on the MEMS accelerometer data acquisition and how to analyze the data, how to post-process the data, and how to do like time domain analysis, frequency domain analysis. This is in continuation of the series what we are having on the MEMS accelerometer. In last session, just in recap, we discussed about various type of accelerometer, what are the sensing principle, and what are the high level characteristics of any accelerometer, and what are the pros cons we need to take care while selecting any accelerometer as in BOM for any embedded product design. Let's get started. So the high level agenda is the data acquisition setup, like how to get the raw data from the accelerometer, what kind of setups we can use in our home, or we don't need any high end setup. So how to use or how to have a low cost setup. So the high level agenda is the data acquisition setup. So here we'll be talking about what is the best effective and the low cost data acquisition setup we can have to analyze the data. And then we will talk about how to analyze the data in time domain, frequency domain, and what are the post-processing we can do. And we can will have be having the demo with some of the available reference hardware. So at high level, accelerometer data acquisition can be done using a commercial mobile phone. You can have any commercial mobile phone, and you can build one application using standard Android APIs that are provided in the sensor manager developer's Android manual. And you can write your own sensor data logger, and you can basically acquire the data of different sensors like accelerometer, magnetometer, gyroscope, temperature sensor. You know, there are many other. It can be proximity and all. But here we'll be mainly focusing on about the Excel data. So let me quickly walk through the developer's Android sensor manager reference manual. So this is, I mean, anyone can write any Android app using this sensor manual. So these are the reference APIs that we need to use to acquire the data, raw data, or the calibrated data from the sensor, and we can basically store that data into the file system in a raw text form or in the form of any CSV file. So if you see, so we can have our own activity. So activity is nothing but your UI based implementation, and which can basically implement this sensor event listener, or you can have your own class, and that class object you can create in the activity, so that you have better isolation with respect to the what data acquisition class. Or you can have another one is like the storage class, and you can have your own algorithms for post processing. So you can refer this. So this is just to give overview. So now let me walk through the one of my reference implementation which I did on my which is available in my GitHub. So you can use this reference for having or writing your own application. So what if you see here, so I'm having one sensor logger class, which is implementing a sensor event listener. In this, I'm having different sensor objects, Excel, gyro, magnetometer, and I have the non-calibrated. So one is the calibrated value, another one is non-calibrated value. So you can, since our main focus is Excel, so let's focus only on this. So then we have the Excel data. Excel data is a global data. So this Excel data is basically, it's the tri-axis, right? So it's, we have the acceleration axis, x-axis, y-axis, z-axis. So this is an array of three. It's float, since to have the better resolution, because x, it can go to like 0 to 9.8 meter per second square, right? So it's plus minus 9.8 meter per second square. So that's why it's float. Now in the constructor of this class, so we have first we get the sensor object. So we get the default sensor, which is type XL, and this is the object. And then we register the event listener. So event listener is to get the retrieve the data. So in the event listener, so on sensor changed is the event listener where we get the data, the sensor events, and we basically then have a switch case to filter out what type of data we are getting, since it will be based on the how many type of sensors we have registered. And we get the Excel data. Now we can have a get method to retrieve the Excel data. So this can be called from the activity which will be creating the object of this class. And once you get the data, then you can use your storage class or your post-processing class to post-process or store in the file system in any format you want. And you can do the post-processing or post-analysis. So this is just a quick overview how to play around or implement one sensor application, which can be your data logger on commercial with commercial phone. And what you will do is basically you will create the application. The APK you can install via ADB install your APK. You need to put your phone in developer mode, and probably you need to enable unsigned app to be installed on that phone. I mean, so there will be one setting in the developer mode which you can enable. Okay, so this is one of the mode which we can use. Another mode is which is quite flexible and which gives a lot of flexibility to play around. So that is with the Raspberry Pi. So you can have Raspberry Pi 0W, you can have Raspberry Pi 3B Plus or Raspberry Pi 4 or even Raspberry Pi CM4. And you can buy one sense hat. So here I am having the WaveShare sense hat which I am using. So this you can basically mount on top of the Pi header, so which is somewhere here, and this is compatible. So this is basically having interface with the Pi over I2C and then normal VCC and ground and other IOs that are being used to exchange the data on exchange the data and the interface with the sense hat. So let me give you the overview of the so this is the sense hat wiki, waveshare.com wiki sense hat. So it has multiple versions, so it's like a B version which I'm showing here. So what are the standard feature? So it has onboard Excel, which is ICM20948. It is integrated. It's Excel, Mag, and Gyroscope. So you have 9 degrees of freedom with this, which you can use to detect movement, orientation, magnetic field. So you know, the gyro and magnetometer we are going to cover in the next session. So let's focus mainly on Excel. So we can get the Excel data from this, and then it has the temperature sensor, it has barometric pressure sensor, and it has color sensor, and it's a onboard ADC which is 4-channel and 20-bit precision. Yeah, so this is giving a lot of flexibility in terms of, because you can play around with multiple sensors. And the good thing while using Pi, if you're using Raspberry Pi, there are other sense hat available, so which has a different BOM. I mean, it has a different vendor, different accelerometer from different vendor. So you can use it, and so that you can play around with multiple type of sensors. And you can even implement your own board. And if somebody is very much into the hardware, so you can design your own PCB, and which is compatible to Raspberry Pi. I mean, you don't need to directly make a PCB or like another system on module which is like compatible with the Pi header. However, you can use like normal pins to connect to your custom board over I2C, VCC, ground, and any other sideband interrupt lines if required. Those can be standard GPIOs available in the Raspberry Pi. So working voltage is 3.3. As I mentioned, interface is I2C. The accelerometer ADC resolution 16-bit. It's quite good. And the ranging is up to plus minus 16G. It means like good resolution we can get. It is not limited to plus minus 1G or 2G. You can even get good dynamic range of the Excel. I mean, so there are certain steps to basically you need to follow. I mean, if you follow this library installation, these are pretty straightforward. You can do it. And after this, you have two way to get the data. One is the Python based data acquisition, and other one is the native based, which is like C based. So you can play around with this, and you can do a lot of modification if you want to change bandwidth, if you want to change dynamic range, and if you want to enable any specific interrupts like any motion interrupt or any other interrupt that is available or provided in the data sheet. So you can play around. It gives a lot of flexibility, unlike the first data acquisition mode what we discussed, that is using the standard phone.
So let's have a quick demo how to use this WaveShare SenseHat. So this is my Raspberry Pi. I'm using 4B, Raspberry Pi 4 and 3B Plus. So right now this particular node is connected, is Raspberry Pi 3B Plus, and I have SenseHat connected. So now you need to basically set up the source code as mentioned in this wiki. So you need to clone few wikis and a few GitHubs, and then you need to basically do some prerequisite, like, so you need Python pip, you need RPA GPIO, SpyDAP, and SMBus libraries if you want to play with the Python based data acquisition samples. Or if you want to use native, then you don't need these Python prerequisites. So this is what I have the working setup. So let me quickly show. So here I am running this Invensys Python script for data acquisition, and you can see that I am getting pitch, role, and yo, that is coming from Gyro. These are the Excel data, and then I have the, it's more or less same pitch, role, yo, and the Gyro data. And I have the acceleration and the magnetic field. So let's focus on the acceleration value. So here it's right now configured as 14 bit ADC. So that's the reason you are seeing the dynamic range is bit higher. So this, what you can do is you can basically log this in text file, and then you can open in Excel and use delimiter to filter out and have the data in the same format how I have shown you for post processing or data analysis. So let's quickly, the implementation is quite simple here. If you see, so if you see here, this is the entry point of this program. So initially we are configuring the ICM 20948, so where we are configuring its basic initial configuration. And once the configuration is done for all of the three sensors, then in a while loop we are getting the data. So, and the same thing is getting printed in the console. So I'm not going much deep like how we are initializing, because that, for that you need to open the data sheet. And once you, this is just the, like, you know, the beginners. So if you want to do some reconfiguration, or if you want to change the dynamic G range, if you want to change the some other parameters, or if you want to explicitly configure some specific interrupts, that you then you can open data sheet, and accordingly you can modify the registers as required. Let's analyze a few of the data which I have captured. So we can basically do analysis of the static data when Excel is just placed on the horizontal surface, and then with some tilt, or with some single tap, with some hammering, and with some like feeble motion in one dimension. So here this is the static data. So if you see, this is x-axis, y-axis, z-axis, and this data I have captured in 25 hertz bandwidth. So this is the sampling rate of the sensor. And if you see, when the sensor is mounted on a horizontal surface, then only the z-axis is experiencing the gravity, which is 9.8 meter per second square. And if you see x and y is, since it's static, it's almost zero. And there is a variation because of the sensitivity. You can see there will be slight fluctuation within plus minus one in the stationary axis. Now this is the plot which tells you, this is the z-axis, x-axis, y-axis. So this is the static data. So what you can do is, once you do the data acquisition, so you can, whatever data you have logged, you can basically have Octave, GNU Octave, similar to this, and you can basically then load that data and you can plot the data. So this is, I mean, I have multiple scenarios. So one is the static data, so which I have shown. So let me quickly show it again. So this is the static data. So you can see z-axis is having plus minus, it's plus 9.8 meters second square, because it's tilted, I mean, it's mounted in a downward direction. So that's why it is experiencing a plus 1g. So, and other x-axis and y-axis, you can see it's, you know, almost in plus minus 1. So this is the one, and you can even go to the frequency domain. So I'll show you how to analyze the data and frequency domain. So let's go back to the deck. This data I have captured with, I did some hammering sound just beside the Raspberry Pi with this handset, so that I can get what kind of data I can have once I do some hammering nearby accelerometer. So if you see the X and Y and Z, so you can see there is a lot of amplitude variation along all three axes. So since I was doing predominantly hammering on the Z axis, so you will be seeing that there is a sharp variation in Z axis. So you can think each peak belongs to like one hammering sound. So let's check more on the, I mean, if I plot this data, I mean the same data if you see here. So this is the data which I was showing in the slide. So you can see that these are the peaks that got generated with my hammering beside Excel or beside the Raspberry Pi. So now this kind of we can do analysis. So what we can do, since it's time domain data, so so what we can do is, first basically we can remove, we can have one high pass, a low pass filter, so that we can remove some unwanted high frequency component, and then we can do DC removals, which is like the 0 hertz frequency component, and then after that we can have some kind of analysis or the feature extraction based on this data to make, to have one, some algorithm implementation to detect this. And nowadays some sensors are basically even providing the interrupt, because this can be implemented in the hard macro, and you can have a interrupt with the pre-configured threshold. If you see, this is, I mean, if you see there is a sharp variation in the amplitude, so you can have some threshold which you can configure, and based on the once your this amplitude with the, which has some this kind of pattern, and it exceeded some threshold, it can basically generate one interrupt. But I mean, so we are talking about the software implementation, so we can analyze this data and have our own implementation for any anti-theft solution. I mean, if you think of a case in home, inside your home automation, or exactly in the IoT use cases, you can have these kind of small nodes that can be used for detecting some hammering sound, I mean, and having some anti-theft solutions. It can alarm based on the activity or the pattern. We saw the time domain data, I mean the time domain analysis of the raw capture what we have. Now let's do the frequency domain analysis of the same data set which I have shown with the hammering sound. So the Excel data, so if you see, this is the frequency domain plot. I mean, let me show octave. So here I have three axis data. So I'm just opening that data, getting, having the file descriptor. And after that, I'm taking the FFT. So I'm taking the Fourier transform, fast Fourier transform of the data. So this is length. L is the length of the data sample of these arrays. I mean, I just taken right now for X. Then NFFT is basically the length of the signal you want to calculate the Fourier transform. So it's the transform length actually, because the nature of FFT algorithm is like it's usually 2 to the power n. So that's the reason NFFT is 2 to the power L, next power of L, because it increases the resolution of the FFT. So after that, I'm just removing the first component to zero. It's like removing the DC offset, 0 hertz component, and then I'm plotting the frequency domain data what we got after FFT. So this is done for all three axes. So now let's quickly plot. So if you see here, so we have removed the DC offset. Now if you see in X axis around like 6 to 7, in between 6 to 7 we have a hertz frequency, we have the peak, and similarly in the Y axis we have around 4 to 5, somewhere around 5 hertz we have the peak, and similarly on the Z axis also we have around 4 to 5. So if you see that, we can see when we did one hammering gesture, and we saw that it has generated the frequency around 6 to 8, or like maybe into 4 to 7, in the range of 4 hertz to 7 hertz. So our area of interest is 4 to 7 hertz in this case. So this is the max frequency component that we can have with this, that particular use case. So with Nyquist criteria, so our frequency, like sampling rate, can be more or less around 15 hertz should be okay. But I mean, since we can have some other characteristics also, like I think we can go around 25 hertz. So we can have, so this data is captured with 25 hertz sampling rate, so which eventually fall, adhering the Nyquist criteria, which is like greater than twice of your max frequency component. So this is, this can be, this analysis can be done with various raw capture. So what you can do is you can always take the time domain data and then take FFT, remove DC hertz, or you can even have the high pass filter. So if you, your sampling rate is higher, then probably you can have one high pass filter, low pass filter, not high pass. So you can have a low pass filter so that you can remove your unwanted component, which is not your area of interest, which is not your really the interest for the actual data. Now let's discuss about what we need to do as part of post processing. So as we understood that first thing is we can remove the DC offset, and we can use one low pass filter to remove high frequency noise. So that is not really, so as we discussed earlier, with any motion we cannot generate beyond around 10 hertz, or we can't really generate more than 10 hertz. So then definitely more than 10 hertz spectrum is not really our part of the interest area. So we can always use a low pass filter of 10 hertz cutoff, and we can have only the data from 1 hertz, 0 hertz to 10 hertz, and 0 hertz will be removed with the DC offset removal. And we can always use the high resolution. So high resolution in terms of the G range, or in terms of the ADC, using the higher bit resolution ADC, that gives advantage of having the more precise and more data at the high resolution. And then we can proper grounding also eliminate some of the noise that can be induced. And other thing is the sensor calibration. So sensor calibration is that is very much required, because of there can be multiple things during manufacturing on the PCB, on the PCB mounting. So there can be some fixed bias or fixed offset because of the mounting, because that is not really mounted at the flat, so it might have some slight inclination, and due to this we need to calibrate and so that we can compensate the offset, remove the offset, and have the sensitivity and offset calculation can be done as part of the sensor calibration, and we can actually get the true value out of the measured value by using the sensitivity and offset. So as part of calibration, so this is the quick introduction. It's not very deep dive, but for a XL calibration, so if you see any accelerometer chip. So you might be seeing one this dot at the top, and it basically gives this is the identification from there. You can basically know what is your x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. So this is the portrait up orientation of the sensor IC, and this is the portrait down. Once this mark goes here, it's a portrait down. It's the landscape left, landscape right, and we can have front and back. So these are like when we have the Z axis pointing to upward, and when Z axis pointing downward, so it's like back. So these are the typical known orientation of any accelerometer. So what generally we do as part of calibration is, first of all, like 1g is 9.8 meter per second square, so this we know very well. So now we need to rotate the accelerometer to these various orientation that are depicted here. So here this is axis, so we know like once it's portrait up, then we can know that the which axis is experiencing the gravity. So in this case, in portrait up, the y axis is experiencing minus 1g. In landscape left, the x-axis is experiencing minus 1g, and similarly front, the z-axis is experiencing. So if you see here in the front, z-axis is experiencing 1g, and in the back, z-axis is experiencing minus g. So using this orientation, so what can be done is we can calculate the sensitivity and offset. So sensitivity across x-axis is equivalent to landscape right minus landscape left x divided by 2. Similarly, sensitivity y is portrait up y minus portrait up y by 2, and z around is front minus back by 2. And these are the offset calculations. So this is like for offset around x-axis, y-axis, z-axis. So once we know sensitivity and offset, then we can always get the calibrated value by using the sensitivity and offset. So you can have A calibrated equal to sensitivity multiplied by A measured plus offset. Offset can be plus minus, so it's like based on the what we calculate, what we get. So it's based on that, its sine extension will be there. So now let's quickly have some overview of what all the vendors we have. So predominantly we have Bosch, ST Microelectronics, Invensys, NXP as the major player who are leading this space, because most of the iPhone and all these handheld devices, mobile phones, they have that is occupied by almost these vendors. So I have listed few that are popular, like VMI-055. So it's 6-axis inertial sensor. So 6-axis because it is having the gyro and XL integrated, so it's having 6 degree of freedom, and it has 12-bit ADC, and these are the different footprints, so like 3 cross 4.5 mm square. And this is Bosch, this is basically Bosch sensor tech. And we have from ST, we have LSM303D LHC. It is a 3D digital linear acceleration sensor, which is having only accelerometer, and it's having I square C, and it is goes to like plus minus 16 G range, and it's available in 3ZA 14 package. And BMI-160 is also from Bosch, so it is 6-axis. And then we have MMA-854, so this is also 3X, it's also 3-axis accelerometer with 14-bit ADC with I2C. Most of them are with I2C, only few are exceptional, which are not giving I2C, only SPI. But mostly they have the flexibility to use either SPI, mostly I2C, but you can, in some of the cases, you have flexibility to use SPI as well. Then you have MPU 6000 and MPU 92540. So this one is 9-axis, so which has XL magnetometer gyroscope, so it has 9 degree of freedom, and it's 3 cross 3 cross 1 mm. So these are like key few of the vendors. So you can always whatever the smartphone you are using, so you can always check as part of your phone stack, and as part of SenseHead when you are using on the Raspberry Pi. So you will already be knowing what kind of sensor you are using, and you can modify. And probably, I mean, so if you can open the data sheet and have, if you want to customize something, you can always customize for your need, because it gives a lot of flexibility. So you can even modify the Linux driver, or you can even modify the sensor HAL, or when you use in Raspberry Pi, you have a lot of flexibility to customize anything from top to down. So this is the rough overview. So Excel data acquisition analysis in time domain, frequency domain with small demo. Hope you would have liked this video. Thanks a lot.